Today's lecture is about the implantation in mammals, and which is highly organized process that involves an interaction between a receptive uterus and a competent blastocyst which is going to implant in the uterus. So before talking about the process of implantation, let's have a review about the structure of uterus at the time of implantation. So the wall of the uterus consists of the three layers: endometrium, myometrium and perimetrium. Endometrium, as you look in the image, it is the innermost lining that is toward the uterine cavity, and myometrium is a thick layer of smooth muscles and which is present between the perimetrium and endometrium lining. Perimetrium is the peritoneal covering lining the outside wall. So perimetrium is the outermost covering of the uterus. So uterus wall is consisted of three layers: endometrium, which is the innermost layer and which is toward the uterine cavity; myometrium, which is the layer made up of the smooth muscles and which is the middle layer; and the perimetrium one, which is the outermost layer of the uterus. From puberty until menopause, uterine endometrium undergoes changes in cycle of approximately 28 days under the hormonal control by ovaries. So during this menstrual cycle, the uterine endometrium passes through three stages, and these are follicular, or you can say proliferative phase, secretory or progestational phase, and the last is menstruation phase. So the proliferative phase begins at the end of menstrual phase, and it is under the influence of estrogen and parallels growth of the ovarian follicle. Now here you can see in the figure, the upward part of the figure is showing the maturation of follicle, whereas in the downward part you can see the proliferation in case of the endometrium. The secretory phase begins approximately 2 to 3 days after ovulation in response to the progesterone produced by this corpus luteum. So after ovulation, the remaining follicle is converted into a structure, yellow structure, we called it corpus luteum, and this corpus luteum secretes progesterone. Under the influence of this hormone progesterone, endometrium is further grows in order to receive the incoming blastocyst. So you can see the changes in the uterine mucosa correlated with those in the ovary. So implantation of blastocyst has caused development of large corpus luteum of pregnancy. You can see in the lower part of the figure the implanted embryo, and as a result of this implanted embryo you can see the large size of the corpus luteum in the above part of the figure. So the large amount of progesterone produced by the corpus luteum of the pregnancy further maintain the pregnancy. So it is the secretory phase of the menstrual cycle in which implantation occurs in the uterus, and before the implantation takes place there occurs an important process, we call it blastocyst hatching. So blastocyst hatching is the simply what the hatching of blastocyst from the zona pellucida. During the entire period from the ovulation until the uterine cavity, the ovum and embryos are surrounded by zona pellucida, and this zona pellucida serves many functions for the developing blastomere. Because it lacks histocompatibility antigens, the zona pellucida serves an immunological barrier between the mother and the antigenically different embryo. It also normally prevents premature implantation of the cleaving embryo into the wall of the uterine tube. So it is an important covering outside the developing embryo. After the embryo reaches the uterine cavity, it begins to shed the zona pellucida in preparation for the implantation by a process called as a blastocyst hatching. Because if zona will be present in the uterus too, then the developing embryo or the blastocyst will not be able to implant itself into the uterus. Therefore, it is highly required that zona pellucida dissolves and the blastocyst releases into the uterine cavity. So for doing this purpose, the trophoblast cells of the inner cell mass side region secrete a protease hormone, proteases enzymes. These are proteases enzyme. So these enzymes are trypsin like, and trophoblast toward the ICM, or you can say inner mast cell, releases these enzymes, and these enzymes digest the zona pellucida and create a small hole into the zona, and blastocyst hatches from the zona by squeezing through this hole. So the process is called as a blastocyst hatching. Once outside the zona pellucida, the blastocyst can now make direct contact with the uterus. So the blastocyst release from this zona pellucida, as is evident from the image in the right hand side, the blue colored structure is zona, whereas the internal structure, which is having a yellow colored lining of cells, which is trophoblast, and an inner cell mass of red color, is the developing blastocyst. So in this figure you can see the process of zona hatching, or you can say blastocyst hatching, in which zona is lysed and the blastocyst is releasing from the zona pellucida layer. So now this expanded blastocyst is ready for the implantation in the uterus. So the uterine milk, which is released by the uterus, will contain certain kind of chemical attractant like chemokines or cytokines, which will further attract the blastocyst toward the implantation procedure, or you can say process. Implantation is simply the process of attachment and invasion of the uterus endometrium by the developing blastocyst. And the process of implantation starts approximately 6 to 7 days after fertilization, and the embryo begins to make a firm attachment to the epithelial lining of the endometrium. Later on, the embryo sinks into the endometrial stroma. This is the connective tissue part of the endometrium, and its original site of penetration into the endometrium becomes closed over by the epithelium, and the part of the endothelium from where the blastocyst has entered, now it has been healed by the multiplication process of the endometrium, and similar to the healing of the skin wound. So successful implantation require a high degree of preparation and coordination by the embryo and the endometrium, because the implantation takes place in the secretory phase of the menstruation cycle. So the hormonal change and the structure of endometrium should be receptive for the incoming embryo. So even before actual contact is made between the embryo and endometrium, the uterine epithelium secretes into the uterine fluid, which contains certain kind of cytokines and chemokines, and these chemical factors further facilitate the process of implantation by attracting the incoming blastocyst toward itself. So the overall, the process of implantation is further divided into three main stages. The first stage is apposition, or simply the contact of initial contact of blastocyst to the endometrial lining. The second stage is the attachment of the blastocyst to the endometrial lining, and the third is the invasion, or you can say penetration, of blastocyst into the uterine epithelium. So in the first stage, that we call apposition, this apposition is simply the contact of blastocyst to the uterus, and in this kind of contact, the blastocyst can further deloge from the area where it is contacting itself. It can change its contact position or further the adhesion, or you can say attachment position, while it is undergoing the apposition stage of implantation. So this apposition is further mediated by the L-selectin molecules on the trophoblast and its receptors that we call the carbohydrate receptors, or mucins, on the uterine epithelium. So the process of apposition is the simple contact of the blastocyst to the uterus, and this process is triggered by the L-selectin molecules, which are present on the trophoblast, and by binding to the carbohydrate receptors, which are present on the uterine epithelium. So these L-selectin and the receptors of this L-selectin on the uterine epithelium interact with each other and they execute the process of apposition, or you can say simple contact of blastocyst to the epithelium, uterine epithelium. The next process that we call the attachment of the blastocyst. So the attachment, and the later on the third one, invasion by the trophoblast, involves integrins. Here the adhesion molecules are integrins which are present on the trophoblast as well as on the extracellular matrix of the uterus or endometrium. So the integrins present on the trophoblast and the extracellular matrix molecule which is present on the endometrium lining. Here in this extracellular matrix, laminin and fibronectin components are present which interact with the integrin. Now this laminin, when combined with the integrin, it will start the process of attachment, or you can say adhesion of the blastocyst, and it is a strong bonding than the initial contact, or you can say apposition. Apposition and attachment are different. Apposition is a loose contact of blastocyst to the uterus, and blastocyst can lose at another site when it initially contact, or you can say apposition process is done at the earlier site. After that, the attachment process is a strong bonding between the blastocyst and the endometrial lining. So the molecules here involved are integrins on the trophoblast and the laminin and fibronectin on the extracellular matrix. This integrin, when combined with its receptor, that is laminin, it will trigger the attachment of blastocyst to the uterine wall. And this fibronectin interaction with the integrin on trophoblast further help to invade, or you can say penetrate, the blastocyst into the uterine epithelium. And when blastocyst attach itself to the uterine wall, the ICM, or you can say inner cell mass region, is toward the uterine lining. Now the third process is the penetration or invasion of blastocyst into the uterine epithelium. So the area around ICM or inner cell mass cells derived from cellular trophoblast fuse to form the multinucleated syncytial trophoblast. Now the trophoblast, which is present above the inner cell mass region, divide mitotically, and these mitotically divided new cells, they fuse with each other and form a syncytial mass, or syncytio, we call it multinucleated syncytio trophoblast. Now the trophoblast is divided into two layers. One is cellular layer that we call cytotrophoblast, which is just above the ICM, and another layer is syncytio trophoblast, that is a multinucleated layer present on the cytotrophoblast. So small projections of syncytio trophoblast insert themselves between the uterine epithelium cells. Now the syncytio trophoblast wall projects in the form of finger-like structure on the uterine epithelium and make the deep contact with the uterine epithelium. The early syncytio trophoblast is highly invasive tissue. Invasive in the sense that it releases certain kind of enzyme which will help to lyse the endometrium lining and further help the embryo to invade into the deep lining of the endometrium, and you can say them the stromal area of the endometrium. So the early syncytio trophoblast is highly invasive. It will help the embryo to invade, and it quickly expands and erode its way into the endometrial stroma. So this syncytio trophoblast will help the developing embryo, or you can say blastocyst, to deeply erode the endometrial lining and lose over there. In these images, we can understand the implantation process more clearly. So in the part A of the figure, you can see the blastocyst attachment at the endometrial lining. Here, the blue colored mass of the cell is the inner cell mass, whereas the gray colored cells, which is present on the boundary, are the trophoblast, now turned cytotrophoblast cells. And at the inner side of the endometrial linings, syncytio trophoblast cells are present, which are just the finger-like projections of the syncytio trophoblast, and these are formed from the trophoblast layer by the various mitotic division and later on the fusion of the cells, and forming the multinucleated structures. So this the syncytioblast structure now invade into the endometrial lining. Here you can see the maternal blood vessels and the capillaries. These are uterine glands present in the figure A. Now in the B part of the figure, you can see the invaded blastocyst further invade into the endometrial, deep into the endometrial lining. And here this invaded, or you can say the developing blastocyst further goes into the deep into the endometrial lining and break down the maternal blood vessels. This structure erode the blood vessels of the mother, and mother maternal blood begins to fill the isolated lacuna that have been forming in the trophoblast. These small trophoblastic lacuna which are present in the syncytial trophoblast that are getting started to fill with the maternal blood. So by breakdown of these maternal capillaries or maternal blood vessels, the blood fills into these lacuna of the syncytial trophoblast. Now trophoblastic processes enter the blood vessels and even share junctional complexes with the endothelial cells. They make junctions with the endothelial cells of the blood vessels. So by the time blood filled lacuna have formed, the trophoblast changes character and it is now not an invasive one. When the maternal blood fills into in these lacuna, now character, or you can say the configuration or nature of the syncytial trophoblast changes from invasive to the non-invasive one. Okay, now the further it doesn't secrete any lytic enzymes. So at this time the leakage of blood from the uterus is called as a spotting, that we call the implantation spotting. So in these two figures we can see the completion of the process of implantation. In the first figure, that is C part of the figure, we can see the cytotrophoblast cells. Cytotrophoblastic cells further fuse to form the syncytial trophoblast all over around the embryo. So syncytial trophoblast is now present all over the cytotrophoblast around the developing embryo. And in case of D, this syncytial trophoblast is further expanded itself deep into the endometrium, and the process of implantation is complete here. In the C figure, you can see a small pore like area from where the blastocyst has entered. This area is firstly healed by the extracellular matrix and later on by the division of the endometrial cells or endothelial lining cells. They divide mitotically, proliferate and heal this area. And here the complete, you can see in the D image, the endothelial lining is completed over the implanted blastocyst. So this is an animated video in which we can see the process of implantation of blastocyst. So in this way the blastocyst completely invaded the endometrium and get implanted into it. So the invasion of syncytial trophoblast into the endometrium is enzymatically processed, and by the help of enzymes this syncytial trophoblast further invade deep into the endometrium. And this process of implantation is completed by 10 to 12 days after fertilization, and the embryo is now completely embedded in the endometrium. The site of initial penetration is first marked by a bare area from where the blastocyst entered into the endometrium. We are talking about that area. So that is after the implantation is firstly healed by the non-cellular plug area and later on by the cellular lining of the uterine epithelium. And the fibroblast like stromal cells of the edematous endometrial swells. Now the endometrium swells, and because of the process of the decidual reaction. So in this decidual reaction, the stromal cells, or these are fibroblast like cells, these cells accumulate glycogen and lipid droplets inside themselves. They will accumulate these nutritional component, glycogen and lipid droplet. Now these cells are called as a decidual cells. These are the connective tissue cells of the endometrium and are tightly adherent and form a massive cellular matrix that first surround the implanting embryo and later occupies most of the endometrium. Means the complete endometrium is changing into the decidua. Now the endometrium cells, after accumulation of this material, that is glycogen and lipid, they change their configuration, they change their secretory behavior, and they change into the decidual cells. So they get tightly adherent around the embryo and form a massive cellular matrix. Now this transformation of the stromal cells to the decidual cells is called as a decidual reaction, and due to this decidual reaction, decidua is formed. That is just the modification of endometrium, and later on this decidua forms the placenta, which will help the developing embryo to respire, to excrete the nitrogenous waste material, and for gaining the nutritional components from the mother blood, maternal blood. So the overall, the process of implantation is further divided into three main stages. The first stage is apposition, or simply the contact of initial contact of blastocyst to the endometrial lining. The second stage is the attachment of the blastocyst to the endometrial lining, and the third is the invasion, or you can say penetration, of blastocyst into the uterine epithelium. So in the first stage, that we call apposition. This apposition is simply the contact of blastocyst to the uterus, and in this kind of contact, the blastocyst can further delodge from the area where it is contacting itself. It can change its contact position, or further the adhesion, or you can say attachment position, while it is undergoing the apposition stage of implantation. So this apposition is further mediated by the L-selectin molecules on the trophoblast and its receptors that we call the carbohydrate receptors, or mucins, on the uterine epithelium. So the process of apposition is the simple contact of the blastocyst to the uterus, and this process is triggered by the L-selectin molecules, which are present on the trophoblast, and by binding to the carbohydrate receptors, which are present on the uterine epithelium. So these L-selectin and the receptors